Good morning. Good to see everyone. The cold is here. We're going to sing first two verses of Oh How I Love Jesus. That's 10 in your hymn books. Was in the first few verses. There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing His word. It sounds like music in my ears. The shall be in his house, and his righteousness endureth forever. Unto the upright there arises light in the darkness. He is gracious and full of compassion, the righteous. A good man showeth favor and lendeth. He will guide his affairs with discretion. Surely he shall not be moved from forever. The righteous shall be in everlasting remembrance. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. His heart is established. He shall not be afraid until he see his desire upon his enemies. He has dispersed. He has dispersed. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. His horn shall be exalted with honor. The wicked shall see it and be grieved. He shall gnash with his teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked shall perish. Amen. I read to you Psalm 112 in its entirety, my daughter, as a blessing to the reading, hearing, and doing of his holy word.
Jesus said the child's voice is a wonderful thing. That children are wonderful, a gift to us. So don't be upset if she's making noises. That's all right. That's all right. She's where she needs to be. That's right. That's right. We just need to learn patience and understanding. So, amen. So this is another wonderful day that the Lord has made for us. You know, we should be glad and that's right. Amen. Every single day. Every day that you get up is a great day. You know, some of us, my throat's kind of messed up, but I still praise God right now. Thanking him for allowing us to rest last night and getting us up this morning and bringing us here, you know. Because we could have just said, oh, it's cold outside. I don't want to go that way. And Jesus could have said, well, those people don't want to listen, so I'm not going to die on the cross for them.
Wouldn't even be here.
So we thank God for another day, allowing us to come to the house of worship and praise him just one more time. So we need to praise him while we can. Praise him with all your heart and all your soul while you still can. So as we do this prayer of thanksgiving, it is a season of thanksgiving, but every day should be season of thanksgiving. You know, we look in our closet and we have an overabundance. You know, we look in our refrigerators, and I've got two refrigerators. They are full. So I thank God, you know. And, you know, there's people that don't even have a refrigerator, you know, or heat right now. You know, so we take things for granted, but, you know, all we have to do is look around us and see all the problems that are going on around us. So this is our sanctuary from right now. So we come here to praise God. You know, he's in control, so let him run things. So as we bow our heads, just think of God's goodness. All wise and eternal Father, the one sits high and looks low, the creator of all things, the sustainer of all things, the Alpha and the Omega. Father God, we come to you now just praising your holy name, thanking you for another day, oh Father.
Thank you.
Thank you for allowing us to get up this morning.
Yes, Lord.
Looking around our home to see if everything was okay. Allowing us to pick and choose what to eat and what to wear.
Yes.
So, Father, we thank you. We thank you for all your mercy, Father. We thank you for your grace.
Yes.
We thank you for your son, Jesus, who hung and died on Calvary's cross for the sins of the world.
Thank you.
Because we know it, we're not worthy of all those things. But because of your mercy and your grace, Lord, you seem fit to allow us another day to come and praise your holy name. Lord, we ask that you forgive us of our sins this day. Cleanse us of all unrighteousness. Fill us with your love that we might be about your business as leading someone to you. We thank you for the saints that are here within the sound of my voice. Those that are on the way, and Lord, those on the side of us, to touch them in a special way. Open their minds and their hearts. Let them know we are still together and come to your house, Lord, and praise you. Because we know that you're worthy to be praised, oh Father. You're more than worthy to be praised. And Lord, we just thank you for our pastor. Pastor White, just touch him, Lord, in a mighty way. That he might preach an uncompromising gospel.
Yes.
And he stands on the rock and lead us the way that you would have us to go, oh Father.
Yes.
We'd be mindful to give you all the praise and glory. So we thank you for the choir that's going to sing songs of Zion to you, oh Father. We just want to thank you for everything, oh Lord, that we take for granted. We take those things for granted, Lord, when we walk around and breathe, and let us be sick, then we don't take it for granted. You know, so as we're well, let us praise you, oh Father. Not just when we get on our backs, and in the hospitals and things, but praise you while we can.
Yes, yes.
Because you're a good God all the time. And you're mindful to keep us in times of trouble. And so, Lord, we just want to come today and pray your holy name. Yes. Bless the man who's going to preach the word. Let someone be receptive to the word.
Yes. Yes.
That they might come running asking, what must I do to be saved?
Yes.
Blessings upon the children today, oh Father. Yes. All over the land, oh Father. We know it's hard. It's hard right now. There's a lot of things going on in this world. You said there would be wars and rumors of wars.
Yes.
Pestilence and famine.
Yes.
And it's going on right now, Father. So we know that we're in end times. We know that we're in end times. And it's a great urgency to get to know you. So let us be bold enough to go out and share your love and your word with someone that don't know you, free pardon of their sins.
Yes.
Be with us this day, and as we go our separate ways, Lord, be with us.
We pray. Amen. Amen.
Good morning,
my
love. Walk with me, Lord. Walk with me. This tedious journey, time I wave my hand,
meet in the conference room. Tuesday, November the 4th, 24th, we will have our Thanksgiving service at 6:30 with Reverend Charles Newman of Columbus, Ohio. Saturday, December the 5th, we'll have the Reflecting Light Ministry. Sunday, the December the 20th, we'll still be going to Kokomo, so if you still want, you can start paying, if you're still interested to go or sign up. On December 24th, we will be having a Christmas Eve celebration at 6:30.
Amen.
And for this, Sister Diane is asking all VBS teachers to invite their students to the program or send them a Christmas card. Miss Sister B and Sister Diane will elaborate on, Miss B will elaborate on the Reflecting Lights, and Miss Sister Diane will do the Christmas right after announcements.
Amen.
So they'll give you more information about all of that, which is why I didn't say anything. Do we have any visitors? Thank you.
Now this is only this the pastor-wise, ministers-wise, and deacon-wise of the state of Indiana. That's all that is. And they are having their Christmas fellowship banquet here the first Saturday in December at 5 o'clock. Now, I was the second vice for years. I'm making this short, Pastor. And I gave the office up. But the president, Sister Ford, has said, we just need a place to hold our fellowship Christmas dinner. And she told me to ask Pastor White, and I did, because you know he said okay. Now at this time, all we had to do was just supply the place for them. They did the program, they buy the food, everything. The president got sick, she had a stroke. So therefore left the first vice president. First vice president fell and broke her hip.
Wow.
Okay, now you know where this is landing now. And so I started getting the call. And I told her, I said, this thing has been dumped in my lap. And he said, okay, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. And oh, he's just been marvelous. But I said this to say that. You know, we're not allowed to sell tickets here.
That's right.
Thank God. And the pastor said, we are not going to charge for these dinners. Everyone is invited, so I'm telling you. But the fact is, you know it costs for food.
That's right.
So we will be taking up, we will be asking for a free will offering that night at the dinner. So, you know, that's free will. But the fact is, I've been asking a few people for help, you know, to help me that night and donation and stuff like that. And it's just been going marvelous.
Amen.
I mean, it is great. Mount Olive, you are great. No one has said no to me, the people that I went to. Hey, I wouldn't be a part of no other church but Mount Olive. You are giving, loving people. You know? And that's going to be credit up there.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah.
I love you. So minister-wise, deacon-wise, that will be your night to shine, to sit with your husband. But I'm going to be working. I'm going to be doing my service tonight. But it's time, that will be time for you to sit back and relax.
Amen.
Pastor, you thank you.
All right. Let me get you real quick. No, you okay?
Good morning, Mount Olive.
Good morning.
Just want to reiterate the free will, whatever you have, we will encourage all members to come and support. So whatever you have, if you don't have it, still come. I've had that in my lifetime. If I didn't have anything, I ate on credit too. So, and I just want to encourage all of us to come Tuesday night. Have a young man, very humble young man, Reverend Charles Newman, from Mount Hermon in Columbus, Ohio. He'll be here with us at 6:30. That'll be our only Thanksgiving service. You have Wednesday to cook and prepare, and Thursday to be with your family. You'll have to leave and go home and come back and live like we've done in time past. We'll try this out if that works. And hopefully, you know, we get the participation. Maybe we can have this at a set time every year to have service and just be Thanksgiving, how we've done in times past, testimony, songs, prayers, and preaching, and we'll go home. Sound like a fair deal.
Yeah.
Amen. God bless you.
And Pastor, yes. After that, we will have preaching that night.
Yes, be preaching that night. And we don't know yet who it'll be.
Yeah.
We're working on a couple of people. If they don't respond, then we'll work on a couple of more. But we'll be preaching that night. And again, we want to encourage all to come. As Sister B said, it's thrown in her lap. She's just her and Sister Jardine have taken and run with it.
Yeah.
And it's going to be successful already.
Amen.
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 Okay.
I'm sorry, yes.
I did forget,
Ms.
B, they are asking for non-perishable items.
Yes. At each church, wherever the banquet is held, we ask people to bring non-perishable items, and that is distributed goes to the church, and they can do whatever it is they want to do with it, the family, whatever.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Thank you. After church services today, I'd like to meet with any children who would like to be in a Christmas play. The play is a simplified version of the birth of Christ Jesus, and I'd like to schedule practice times and dates. So I'm excited for the children about this play. They will be dressed up in costumes, and we're going to have a Christmas party the night of the program. So please, please encourage your children to participate.
Yes.
And I'm hoping all of our children here be in the play. Again, that meeting will be right after services today. We'll probably be meeting right up here in the front. So please bring all your children. And like I said, I'm so excited about it. Thank you.
Amen.
I love to praise Him.
I love to praise His name.
I love to praise Him.
I love to praise His name.
I love to praise Him.
I love to praise His name.
Here.
I love to praise
Everybody on this side, please stand and follow the direction of the usher in the room.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He will dwell with them. They shall be his people. God himself shall be with them and be their God. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. There shall be no more death, neither sorrow, crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." And he that sat upon the throne said, "The whole I make all things new." He said unto me, "Write, these words are true and faithful." And he said unto me, "It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh shall inherit all things." I will be his God, and he shall be my son. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which hath made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will not slumber. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep.
Yeah.
The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. Sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time forth and even forevermore.
May we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for just allowing us the privilege to come out and just say thank you, Father. You've been so good to us, Father. Father, we just can't thank you enough for all the blessings you've given us brought us through the week, Father. Father, we ask that you take this offering and you just use it for the uplifting and glorification of your kingdom, Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let's rejoice and be glad in it. It's prayer time.
Can't you hear the hammer ring?
Right here.
Can't you hear the hammer ring?
Sure,
he died.
Sure, he died.
just thank you for surely.
Thank you, Jesus.
Sure enough, this time. How the basis of our salvation.
Yeah.
Basis of our forgiveness. The basis of our eternal life.
Yes.
Thank you for your sacrifice.
Yes.
As we went in our mind to hear the hammer ring.
Yes.
We went in our mind to hear you call me your father.
Yes.
We just have to concur with the songwriter who says, surely.
Surely.
He died.
Yes, sir.
I pray that you forgive me of my sin. Cleanse me from my righteousness. You stand in my body. Think with my mind. Speak with my mouth. Things that I'm prepared for your people. That are the words of my mouth. And the taste of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Want to really get the church messed up. Start talking about some kind. I'm talking about messed up in a good way.
Y'all
try to set me up.
All right.
To the preachers who are here and rocking with me.
Thank you, Pastor. God bless you.
Gibson, Potter, and Tatum, and Bentley. I want to again thank them for their support, even though the last three I've named tried to ambush me when I had them on. Maybe they're gonna be next Sunday night, so I guess he gonna join the crowd. I want to thank them for their support. And again, it's a privilege and honor to work with them as they meet and discuss and deal with preacher issues. And also for the deacons and as well as not all their family and friends that are here, greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Good to see you all. I don't want to hold you long. I struggle with what I was going to do, and I was going to do 8 verses of this particular book, and I could only get one done. 6th chapter of Isaiah, verse 1. I'm going to do all this other that went in this. I'll make mention of some of the other verses, but I just couldn't get but one verse done. Yeah, Isaiah, the 6th chapter. That's in the Old Testament. First verse. Isaiah in the 6th chapter. First verse says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Talk from simply this subject, a glimpse of the glory of God. The old song Dr. Fleetwood Irvin used to sing in California, only a look at Jesus. I couldn't find it in him. So it's probably in the Gospel Pearl somewhere, but it ain't in him. A glimpse of the glory. Isaiah is called the Book of Salvation.
Amen.
The name Isaiah means the salvation of the Lord. Or the Lord is salvation. Isaiah is the first book containing the writings of the prophets of the Bible.
Wow.
And the author himself, Isaiah, shines above all other writers and prophets of Scripture. His mastery of the language, his rich, vast vocabulary, his poetic skill have all earned him the title the Shakespeare of the Bible.
Yeah.
He was educated, distinguished, and privileged, yet remain a deeply spiritual man.
Yeah, yeah.
Because of his ability to see, he was known as what some writers called him as the eagle eye.
Eagle eye.
Yeah, all right.
He was committed to obedience during his 55 to 60 year ministry as a prophet of God.
Yeah.
A strong tradition suggests that he died a martyr's death.
Yeah.
Under the reign of King Manasseh, by being placed in the hollow of a tree trunk.
Yeah.
And sawed in half.
Wow.
The book itself has been called in some circles the miniature Bible.
Yeah.
As it has 66 books.
All right.
The first 39 books contain very strong messages, judgment against Judah, and a call to repentance and holiness. The people, like they are in our day, were guilty of outward religious performances that included a form of godliness, but their hearts on the inside were corrupt and defiled.
Yeah.
The last 27 chapters contain God's message of forgiveness, consolation, and hope, as God speaks through Isaiah, revealing his plan, his blessing and salvation through the coming Messiah.
Well,
and so here in this sixth chapter of his prophecy, it's probably one of the most familiar and most often read and preached passages of his writings.
Wow.
The content of Isaiah 6 is inexhaustible. That's one of the reasons it had only do one verse.
Yeah.
There's so much that just kept coming
so
up. And so the more one studies it, the more meaningful and breathtaking and exciting it becomes.
Yeah.
It causes one to wonder what he experienced when he got to get a glimpse of God.
All right.
It was an experience the prophet never forgot. Like Paul, never was there a time when memory failed him, when he told of his story, of his unexpected encounter with God.
Yeah.
He, like all others who've had this kind of experience with God, found himself overwhelmed and speechless.
Yeah.
The wonder and amazement was unparalleled with anything else in his life.
Wow. Yeah.
But now Isaiah does not try to pinpoint the day nor the hour of his encounter with God. But he excitedly said that it was in the year that King Uzziah died. Whenever that was. History said that Uzziah was reckoned as one of the most illustrious kings of his day. Only David and Solomon exceeded him in greatness. And it was reported that Uzziah was a good man. He came to the throne at the young age of 16, Harrison.
Yes.
He ruled wisely under the tutorship of a man by the name of Zechariah.
Yes, sir.
Who understood God's ways and dealings with God's people.
Yes.
When he first ascended to the throne, Uzziah determined to do what was right in the sight of God.
Yes.
He sought divine guidance, as did David, Solomon, Asa, Hezekiah, and young Josiah. And because of his faithfulness, God caused him to prosper. So Uzziah rode inside. He had servants that would move in haste at his every command. He lived in luxury, while at the same time, he was never too good for the common people.
Yes, sir.
With his own hands, he planted vineyards and orchards.
Yeah. All right.
He was instant in his ability to take care of the business for the advancement of his kingdom.
Yes, sir.
And for all those who served him both night and day.
Yes.
He built great walls around the capital city and set watchtowers upon the walls, which were occupied by watchmen 24 hours a day. He had an army composed of 370,000 soldiers who were led by generals and captains of his choosing.
Yeah.
One had said that Uzziah was a wellspring giving refreshing water to thirsty souls.
Come on, preacher.
He was lauded and held in high esteem by both the upper class, the middle class, and the lower class.
Yeah, yeah.
And with such an illustrious person constantly before him, no wonder Isaiah idolized him.
Yes, sir.
Uzziah was a young king with great ambition, and a young man who had achieved great success. He was a man of great character, and he had the respect of his cabinet. He had the respect of his countrymen. So it was no wonder that Isaiah looked to him as a role model.
Wow.
Now, Isaiah himself was young. He was a moving figure in the king's palace.
Yes, yes.
And he was acquainted with what they call the higher-ups.
Yeah.
And as a result, no doubt, Isaiah envisioned the day when he would carry on in Uzziah's absence.
Yes.
When he would have servants waiting on his slightest commands. He envisioned the day when he would sit upon the throne, arrayed in kingly attire. But we must be careful, Mount Olive, how we idolize people. We must be careful how we allow others to influence us. We must be careful how we are swayed by another's word. You see, kings die, and their crowns and robes are given to others. Therefore, it's not wise to be wrapped up and wrapped around them too tight. Men come and go, whether they be kings or princes.
Yes, sir.
But to wrap ourselves around them so tight,
yes,
that even our vision of God is eclipsed, is sinful. From the top of Mount Sinai, with the words of thunder that God had uttered, thou shalt have no other gods before me.
Yes.
You see, if all the kings and princes of the earth would die at one time,
uh-huh,
that wouldn't affect God's program.
No.
If all of the preachers walk off the job, declaring that we're not going to preach anymore, God will simply raise up a new prophet.
Yes.
Come on, heaven. If all the deacons and trustees and choir members and ushers decide, I'm through. And the congregation said, we're walking out.
Yeah.
We're going to lock the doors and board up Mount Olive. It wouldn't hamper God's program.
No.
Man, this ought to let us know that none of us are indispensable. We can't hold God hostage. He was here when we came, and he'll be here when we're gone. And so we ought to walk humbly with him. And when it comes to King Uzziah, it's worth noting that eventually his power, popularity, and influence went to his head. You should say years ago, he got the big head.
Yeah.
He ended up getting the big head.
Yeah.
And he, like men who rise to power, became haughty and high-minded. He became vain and self-absorbed. So much so that he took it upon himself to try to act in behalf of the high priest. He disregarded God's appointment of the high priest and took it upon himself to enter the Holy of Holies, where the feet of the priests were only to tread. And with the priest forbidding him, he went on deliberately and stubbornly. And he went on, and that's where God's only appointed was supposed to be. And so he goes in offering unauthorized sacrifices. But no sooner than he entered the threshold, Thomas, before he was stricken with leprosy and banished to exile, he overrated himself, and he forgot where to draw the line. It's good to know and to be aware of where your stopping place is. It's good to know where your boundary line is, so that you won't violate God's law.
Yeah.
Because when you go too far, God will step in, and he will stop you.
Yeah.
And believe me, when God stops you, you stop. If God lets you alone, you done. I get a text every once in a while about a certain team that keep losing. And somebody sent a text and said, stick a fork in it. That means they're done. And so God doesn't have to really do too much at all to stop us. He can just will it to be so. And this is what Uzziah failed to realize. Any man who defies God is on his way out. Any man who becomes high and mighty is on his way down. Any man who stiffens his neck to God will have to deal with the consequences of his unholy error.
Shortly after he was stricken with leprosy, King Uzziah died. And this was a sad day for Isaiah, for his whole life was wrapped up in Isaiah. Uzziah was his idol. And now that he was dead, all of his hopes and dreams that he thought he had come to an end. He threw up his hand, for he felt that the future was over. And many people are like Isaiah today. They have wrapped themselves around other people and earthly things so tight that they can't even see God. And it's only when these idols are removed that they can finally get a glimpse of God and his eternal purpose for their lives. Nothing hurts worse than to lose a dear loved one. But sometimes God has to remove them from us so that we might see him. He sometimes has to remove a mother or a father in order for the child to see him. He sometimes has to move a husband from a wife so that she can see he's the all-sufficient God. He sometimes has to move a wife from a husband to stop him from his wild, reckless ways so that he can see God. He sometimes throws us in the world alone with no one to care so that we might know him as our company. The removing of Uzziah was the best thing for Isaiah, even though he felt life was meaningless without him. It's interesting to note that God never empties a space in our lives that he doesn't fill with something better. Sorrow and loss are meant to prepare us for a better and more clearer vision of God. God has to continually move earthly things, earthly kings like Uzziah, so that we might see the King of Kings. He puts out our little light that we might see the light of the world. He puts out our secondary light that we might see Jesus, the true light, and the light of lights. You see, us eyes in our lives have to die in order for us to see the God who lives. There's something worth our notice in us eyes, man. It was seen that with all of his influence, with all of his political power, and the closeness that he shared with Isaiah, that there will be a long period of mourning. But when we take under consideration the statement that follows, the announcement of Uzziah's death, where Isaiah says, he saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filling the temple, we can readily see why the glory of Uzziah was overshadowed. Because divine presence always overshadows human time. There's no compatibility between hope and despair. There's no comparison between joy and sorrow. There's no comparison between delight and dismay, nor between life and death. And there's no comparison between God and Uzziah. As a result, when Uzziah died, the glory of the Lord filled the temple. Then as angels bowed before him crying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, Isaiah became awe-stricken because of the holy countenance of God. Seeing such a holy light, Isaiah also saw Uzziah's impotence and his own impotence and his own undone condition. As a result, he cries, woe is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. And this is always the case when a man sees God in the beauty of holiness. He can never remain the same. And somebody's arguing with me, said, now wait, Brother Pastor, hold on. I thought John said that no man has seen God at any time. And didn't God tell Moses that no man can see him and live? And doesn't Paul say God dwells in unapproachable light whom no man has seen or can see? And the answer to all these questions is yes. But the Bible also points out that what Jacob declares, I've seen God face to face. He also says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So it's obvious the phrase to see God is used in two different scenarios. Man cannot see God in his essence. That's too much power for mere humans to be exposed to. And that's one of the reasons we've got to have a glorified body. Let me break off a little bit for a minute. You remember Moses, when Moses says, I want to see your glory. And God said, Moses, now you can't see me anymore. That's too much, but I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going to put you in a cleft of a rock. And then I'm going to cover it with my hand. That will allow my goodness to pass by the rock. And then when my goodness passes by, I lift my hand. And so he put Moses in a rock. And his presence went by. He lifts his hand and Moses gets a peek at his back part. He said, you can look at my face and live, but you can look at my back part. You can look at my back part, but you can't see my face and live. And when Moses came off the mountain, there was a glow on his countenance because he had been in the presence of God. That's in Exodus 33 if you want to do a reference. And I didn't add it on the paper. But man can only see God as he reveals himself. Anytime a person sees God, it's an indication that God has adapted himself to the limited capacity of the creature. We don't know God as he really is. We know God as he manifests himself to us. That's one of the reasons that he took upon himself the form of a servant and made himself in the likeness of me. At various intervals of time, God comes across the hills of history and stops men of every class, race, nation, and tongue, as he did Isaiah, to let them know that he is God. Whenever and wherever a man meets God, he can never forget it. He may ignore it, but he can never forget it. When one comes into contact with God, he comes into contact with unique, matchless, and unequal greatness. When Isaiah saw God arrayed in the beauty of holiness, he could find no suitable words, no phrases to describe his greatness. His best description was that God was high and lifted up. And that's always his position. He's lofty. He's high. He's holy. He's the great I am of eternity. The psalmist met God in the solitary splendor of a moon and starlit night. He found himself handicapped for words. And his language to describe him was impoverished. So after gazing all night at the stars and the fact that no man was holding them in their places, and after looking at the moon and seeing that no man was holding the moon, all he could say of the indescribable greatness of God when the heavens declare the glory of God and the firmament show his handiwork. The poet hymn writer met God one night and watched him as the battering ram of a storm raged on, seemingly unrestrained. And he said, oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider the world thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sing my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. We can never know how great God is until we get a glimpse of his glory. We can never know how great God is until we have a personal encounter with him. Every page of human history has been colored with the goodness of God. Every star which hangs in the balance of the sky is a testament of the greatness of God. And then when we consider the heavens, the work of his fingers, the moon and the star that he's ordained, we've got to ask the same question that the psalmist asked. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou shouldest visit him? So when Isaiah got a vision of God, he saw God as he was. Then he saw himself as he was. Then he saw the people as they were, vile and undone in God's holy sight. Can I get a witness? When we look around us and see the corruption, the wickedness, the killing that makes bad in man, then we get a glimpse of God, who's absolutely free from any contamination, but stands out in holiness and brightness. When we fall prostrate before him in reverence, and then rise to the sound of the angel singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts." A glimpse of God makes men see themselves as Isaiah did. And we have to say, "Woe is me, for I am undone." All of his adult life, Isaiah's vision was eclipsed by Uzziah. Uzziah was his idol and his ideal. But in losing Uzziah, he found his Lord. There are a lot of people who cannot see God because of their Uzziah. They have no mind of their own. They do no thinking for themselves. They go where their Uzziah tell them to go. They do what their Uzziah tell them to do. The Uzziah tell them to lay down, they lay down. The Uzziah tell them to get up, they get up. They allow their Uzziah to shape their mind. They live for their Uzziah companionship. They hate everybody their Uzziah hate. They're mad at everybody their Uzziah are mad at. They depend on their Uzziah for courage. They live under their Uzziah's shadow. They think their Uzziah's thoughts and behave the way their Uzziah behave. That was the life of Isaiah until he had a glimpse of the glory of God. When he saw God, he saw absolute holiness. He saw beauty in his beauty and purity in purity. He saw justice and wisdom. He saw right and righteousness. He saw goodness and power in his fullness. He saw kindness in action. And Reverend Bentley, he saw heaven in a jubilant stir. He saw angels worshiping in a state of readiness. Don't we sing the song, "Angels bow before him"? Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. You see, when a man sees God, he can know the wonders of his love, the marvels of his grace, and the tenderness of his mercy. When a man sees God, he can experience his wisdom, the love of his counsel, the pleasure of his companionship, and the joy of his fellowship. When a man sees God, he can know the rightness of his way, the straightness of his path, the truth of his judgments, and the infallibility of his word. I tell you, when a man sees God, he can see his son, Jesus the Christ. For Jesus said, "If you see me, you see the Father." And then he said, "I and the Father are one." Because God in himself is so high, he can't go over him. He's so low, he can't go under him. He's so wide, he can't go around him. He's got to go through the Son. And the Son says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man come to the Father but by me." And how, brother preacher, does the Son qualify to have all of this clout with the Father? The same writer, Isaiah, says later on, "He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we healed. The Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all, and he was led away as a lamb before the slaughter." And on Calvary's hill, he died. He died for your sin and mine. That's why he's got clout with the Father, because he died in my place. And he died in your place. They took him down and put him in a borrowed tomb. But that's not how the story is. Right early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hand. And after he rose, he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. They got a glimpse. He was seen of more than 500 at one time. They got a glimpse. He was seen of James and all of the apostles. They got a glimpse. He was seen by Paul on Damascus. so much.
Out there.
So much.
Thank you.
Needs to have that personal relationship. See, we can be religious about a lot of things. I can religiously go to work. I can religiously go fishing. It's not about religion. It's about a relationship. We must have a personal relationship with the Lord. Maybe someone out there has not that personal relationship. Now is the time. You heard the word this morning. Lord have mercy. Maybe someone needs to rededicate. Maybe. See, you don't want to be scared to come up. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Don't be ashamed of who you are. God has made you. For his glory. He wants you to live for him. Come to him. He says, come to me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. This just means you can't carry this burden of sin by yourself. And he just says, come give it to me. If you give it to him, you have to worry about it no more. Now we sin. We all sin. Fall short of the glory of God. But he's a faithful God. He's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us of our unrighteousness. And he restores us to full relationship with him. See, we really never lose our relationship. We lose our fellowship. And he just wants you to come back to him. So he can bless you. And then if you've not ever accepted him, he wants you to come to him. I've been talking to a person and they're not saved, and they said, well, I pray every day. And I said, that's good. I said, but he's not going to hear a prayer unless it's a prayer of repentance. And once you're there, then he can start doing things for you. We sing a couple of verses of come to Jesus. If there be one, would you please come?
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
conviction, right? Years ago when I was coming up, the doors are always open. Anytime a person wants to come here, you come. If you want to come after the benediction, it doesn't matter. That's when I came. December 12th, 1969, 9 o'clock. I didn't know what the doors of the church meant. Open, man. And I looked back, there were ushers were locking. So I went up after. Right. The person who's got any questions, whatever, about coming to Christ.
Amen.
Being a member here or being sure of your salvation, whatever it may be. Those are always there. Anybody at any time. Amen. So I do you have anything, Phil, or just want me to just do a...
I think I might
forget. You know, no ring jump, sorry. All right,
Bill. Thanks,
sir. You know he can't get back, man. You know he's happy. Be here.
Now and forever. Shall we all say together?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.